Hi, this is Bishop Frank Dupre. It's time for another drive-by message. Today I want to talk to you about how God knows how to set the stage to do something incredible. You know, today with all the religion that's in the church of the Lord Jesus all around the world, there's so little understanding about special days, days that meant so much in ages past, in times gone. And yet today they're passed over in the so many churches don't even understand the Christian calendar. Like, what are the important times and seasons and holy days and things like that? The Jewish people had a great understanding of that because, of course, Moses brought them their laws where they had to keep certain festivals. There were seven festivals, major ones, that the Jews had. And then there were three of those that every man had to come to Jerusalem for. Everyone had to come to the tabernacle in the time of Moses. But later on, they came, of course, to Jerusalem. Those three festivals are the key festivals of Christianity. Two out of the three you'll understand and you'll know right away. And the first one, of course, is the most popular and the one that is celebrated more than the other two. And that's Easter, Easter Sunday. It's Passover. And Passover was the first of the great festivals or feast days or holy days. And the Bible tells us that Christ is our Passover and he has been slain. He is the Lamb of God that was slain. And so Passover it has come to a spiritual fulfillment, okay? And the second one is the one that we all know, but it's one that is not really given a lot of importance in the church world. It's the Feast of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover. 50 days after Jesus was raised from the dead, we have the Sunday of Pentecost, and we celebrate that. Now, most people just think of it as a holy day. It's a day of, you know, when the Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came and came upon the apostles and those in the upper room. And, you know, it's a beautiful thing to remember. But again, it's one of those holy days or festival days that the Jewish men had to appear before the Lord for. So there's something special about it in the mind of God. And the third one is the Feast of Tabernacles. That happens in the fall. And that one we have not yet seen spiritualized. We have not seen that fulfilled yet. Pentecost was fulfilled spiritually because that is when the Holy Spirit did come down from heaven upon the apostles and those in the upper room, and it was a rushing mighty wind that appeared, and then tongues of fire came out of heaven and landed on the head of each person in the upper room, and they began to speak in other tongues, began to prophesy about the things of God, and Peter preached his first message under the power of the Holy Spirit, and in that message, 3,000 souls were added to the church. Now, I just want to talk to you for a minute about how God knows how to set the stage, okay? Now, of course, I'm driving, so I got to be careful here as I'm driving, but I always try to pick a good spot where I don't have too much to worry about as I'm going along. Matter of fact, I'm even going to have a little morning sip of my cappuccino. So good. Okay, back to God setting the stage. See, God wants to set the stage in your life too. He wants to have things prepared and have things ready for great special times and special events in our lives. And we can see this in the Feast of Pentecost. Now, I may get to preaching on you a little bit because this excites me. I love this story of what God did. Because Pentecost is one of those three special holy days and all the Jewish men had to be in Jerusalem at the time of Christ, thousands and thousands of people converge upon Jerusalem for the celebration. And they get there a couple of days early. They set up places where they're going to stay, staying with relatives, all this stuff is going on. It's a tremendous time. And it's the beginning of the season where they're looking for different harvests to come along over the late spring and the summer and then the fall. Mostly, of course, late spring and fall, because you have some crops that grow real quick and they harvest them, and others take the summertime. So Pentecost is the festival of the promise of a harvest. And this is what the Holy Spirit did on Pentecost Sunday. He promised the church there's going to be a harvest. There's going to be a plentiful harvest of the church. Souls are going to be saved throughout the world, throughout the ages, and many are going to be added to the kingdom of God, and our Lord Jesus Christ will be glorified. So here's what he does. A few days before Pentecost, several of the priests go out into a field. They encircle a sheaf of wheat or barley, rye, whatever it is that's growing at the time. And they encircle that with a thread. And then on Pentecost Sunday in the morning, They come out at 6 in the morning when the sun rises, and they go out there, and with special prayers and special annunciations, they cut that sheaf of wheat and wave it before God and then bring it to the tabernacle or the temple. And it's at 6 o'clock in the morning, the apostles and the disciples are getting together, and they're going to the upper room, and they're going to be there for the hour of prayer. It is a holy day. They're not going to the temple. They're going to meet together, and they're going to pray on Pentecost together as a body of believers. So they are going to the upper room. Now they get to the upper room, and it's just before 9 o'clock. Now there's 120 believers in the upper room, and there's 120 priests that are getting ready to blow silver trumpets at 9 o'clock, at the hour of prayer. When the hour of prayer strikes at 9 o'clock, 120 silver trumpets will announce it's Pentecost, it's a holy day, it's a feast day, a festival, and God is promising us a great harvest. Here's the proof: we have a sheaf of wheat and we have harvested it from the field. And let us celebrate the goodness of our God. Well, at that same time, just before 9 o'clock, Jerusalem is filled with thousands and thousands of pilgrims all throughout the streets, coming and converging to the temple, and the upper room is not far from there. And so as these thousands of people are in the streets, milling about, getting their way to go to the temple, all of a sudden a wind begins to blow. Now what happens? Mothers are holding their children and gathering their kids close to them. Fathers are shielding their families, and animals are getting a little excited. You know, donkeys are braying, and the chickens are fluttering around, and the birds are flying away, and all this commotion is happening because this tremendous, great, mighty, rushing wind, fast blowing wind is coming into Jerusalem, swooping through the streets. If you've ever been in New York City on a windy day, you know what I'm talking about. In those canyons, those streets that have the high buildings, when the wind comes through, boy, it comes flying through. Well, this is what was happening in Jerusalem. Everybody's attention is being gotten by God because he's bringing this tremendous, rushing, mighty wind to grab their attention. And then somebody cries out, "There's a fire in the sky." God sends a fireball coming down from the sky. Fire being the power of the Holy Spirit. Wind being his resource and his means of travel. Fire coming down. And the fire is there, just like when Solomon dedicated the temple and fire came down from heaven consuming the sacrifices. The fire is coming down, like when Elijah called fire down upon his enemies and consumed his enemies. Well, fire is coming down, and people are wondering, why is this fire coming out of the sky? Look, and it lands, it goes on top of this one place, and they're like, it must be filled with horrible sinners. They must be terrible. What could it be that they've done that God is punishing them on this holy day? Fire is going to consume them. And they're waiting to see what's happening, and they're in awe. Again, you know, mothers are shielding their children from this thing, and the streets are filled with awe as they're wondering what's going on. And all of a sudden, out of the building, somebody cries out, "There's somebody coming out! There's somebody coming out!" And Peter comes out with others, the apostles and the disciples, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, others are there. And as they get there, they're drunk and filled with the Holy Spirit. It's 9 o'clock in the morning, the hour of prayer. 120 silver trumpets are blowing in the temple, and 120 believers who are silver because they've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Silver is the metal or the symbol of redemption. 120 believers are prophesying and speaking in tongues. That's the new blowing of the trumpets. That's the shifting of an age, moving from the old into the new. And they are coming out of the upper room, and people are gathered around, and they're all coming in close, and the crowd is getting packed. There's thousands of them there in the plaza or in the street nearby. And Peter stands up as some of the people are mocking, saying, "Oh, they're all drunk. They're drunk with new wine." Peter stands up and says, "It's 9 o'clock in the morning. We're not drunk the way you think we are," because they were filled with God's Holy Spirit, so much so that they seemed to be inebriated. And he began to preach the first message he ever preached under the power of the Holy Spirit, and guess what? 3,000 people were saved that day. Does God know how to set the stage to get people saved? Does God know how to set the stage to announce a new covenant? Absolutely. That's what he did. He did it on Pentecost Sunday, a holy day when everyone had to go to Jerusalem, and he did it with bringing in a rushing, mighty wind and fire from the sky. And that fire, when it came into the upper room, you know it landed and split up into 120 tongues of fire, each one landing on the head of one of those apostles and disciples in the upper room. And they all began to speak in tongues. Jesus said, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Wait for me in the city of Jerusalem. And they waited, they received the power, the promise was fulfilled. And here's the best part, my friends. This promise is for you, because Peter preaches and says, that which you see and hear, this promise of the Holy Spirit, promised by Jesus, is for you and your children, and for as many as are afar off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. So the promise of Pentecost is yours. Receive the Holy Spirit. Get to church on Pentecost Sunday and get filled with the Holy Spirit. And if you can't get to church on Pentecost Sunday, get before God in prayer and your Bible and ask the Lord to touch you. Let me pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray you send the power of the Holy Spirit to those that are watching and listening to my voice right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, let the blessing and the promise of Acts chapter 1 verse 8, the power of the Holy Ghost, come upon them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. I love coming to you like this. Let me know how you like these videos, and visit me on my website, www.frankdupre.com. We're under reconstruction right now, but you can still get announcements and things like that. So God bless you in Jesus' name.